Okay.
Allen, just kind of want to start at the beginning, you know, like your earliest recollections of, you know, being a kid and growing up, what stands out for you?
I don't know, I guess what stands out the most is where I come from. I think when my mom first left my grandmother's crib, I was like 5 years old, and we lived in a projects in Hampton. I stayed there for, I don't know, a year or two, and left and went to Newport News, and that's where she raised me at, in a project called Stuart Garden. You know, that's where I started to meet all my friends. And basically a lot of the guys that I, you know, still know right now. A lot of them are dead, a lot of them went to jail. But a lot of them I don't, you know, deal with anymore. And some of them I do have dealing with. I think the projects is like probably the funnest place you can grow up at. You know, so many things to do. You know, I played a lot of sandlot football, pick up basketball games, a lot of sandlot baseball, all kinds of stuff, you know.
What's your earliest recollections of basketball and sports?
I really didn't play basketball too much until I got like 8 years old. I was a football player, baseball player. I came home one day and my mom said, you know, today you're going to basketball practice. And I was like, nah, I'm not going to basketball practice. I don't play basketball, I play football and baseball. And you know, I told her I thought basketball was soft. And you know, I just didn't like it. And she said, well, your coach is on his way. He's coming to pick you up and you're going. I cried all the way out the door. I didn't want to go at all. And finally I got in the van and it took me to practice. I got there and seen guys that were on my football team. And you know, I had a good time. And I came back home and I thanked her for it, because I really did enjoy myself. I couldn't wait to get at it again. It's history ever since then. You know, I've just been playing ever since. You know, so, you know, she was really a big part of me playing basketball.
How tough was it for her? And you talk a little about some of the sacrifices that, you know, she went through at the time.
Yeah, because she had to do a lot, you know, to make sure that I had whatever I needed to play sports. You know, I remember one time we went on an AAU tournament when I was 13, and we didn't have no lights on in the house because she spent the money for the light bill on my sneakers. And I wanted these certain sneakers so bad. It was Nike Revolutions. And I wanted them so bad. They were like two sizes too big, but they were the last pair. She bought them for me. And, you know, I went to Kansas. We won it. And came back. Somehow the lights were on, though. You know, I mean, she used to do a whole lot to sacrifice for me. You know, she just did everything that it took for, to put me in a predicament to be where I'm at right now. You know, a lot of stuff I really don't want to talk about, what she went through being able to do those things, but she did a lot. You know, that's why she's my role model, because, you know, I was there and witnessed, you know, the things that she had to go through to make sure I got an opportunity to do what I'm doing right now. So, you know, people always used to ask me who was my role model, who I looked up to. I never looked up to entertainers or basketball players, football, baseball, et cetera. Always looked up to my mom. Like, she was the one that told me that I could be anything that I wanted to be. And just by her telling me that, you know, I believed it. And, you know, I guess, you know, that's one of the reasons why I'm here now. You know, I remember in my neighborhood, guys used to, I used to tell guys that I was gonna be a professional football player or basketball player. And they used to laugh, you know. And, you know, they used to tell me, you know, why do I think I'm gonna be one of the ones to make it to the NBA? He used to always tell me, nobody from Newport News ever made it to the NBA. You know, why do you think you're gonna make it? It's only one out of a billion. And I used to remember teachers telling me that as well. And, you know, guys laughing about it. And, you know, I used to always say, you know, my mom said I can do anything I wanted. And that was kind of like a joke to them. But, you know, I'm not laughing at them now. But now I'm the one doing the laughing.
You know, your senior year was taken away from you. Well, I mean, you've worked to this moment, you know, and all of a sudden everything, you know, just seems to be taken away by something that wasn't true. I mean, you know, Gary was talking about, like, you just never got down with that. And, I mean, these articles and the social stuff, I don't understand how you could. You know, it just seemed like it would have devastated
something.
Can you talk, like, what that was like?
Before I went to court, I asked my grandmother, may she rest in peace, I asked her if God know, because she was a real religious lady, and I asked her, I said, if God know that I didn't do these things that these people are accusing me of, you know, why is he letting this happen to me? And she told me never to question God. And, you know, ever since then, you know, 18 years old, I never questioned him. You know, 10 years later, I never questioned God ever again in my life. You know, I just deal with whatever happened to me. You know, I feel like everything happens for a reason. And I don't think he's going to put me in something that I can't handle. And whenever something negative happened to me, I try to just learn from it and turn it into a positive, you know, and make sure the mistakes that I make, I don't make them twice. And just try to be strong as I can, just for myself and for my family. And, you know, when all that was taken away from me, I just tried to be as strong as I could, you know, and it was tough for me when I got locked up because, you know, people would never let it go away. Like, it was in the paper for, you know, a month or two straight. You know, it was on the TV every day. Then people was rallying, meeting in churches and stuff like that. And, you know, on the flip side of it, I felt good too because I know I had people out there that wanted me to do something with my life and supported me. But I felt like, you know, instead of being down on myself, I had to somehow get out of there and try to start all over. All I wanted and asked for from God was a second chance. And I knew that I had to get my mom and my sisters out of the, you know, the living predicament that they were in. And all I did was wish for another opportunity. And once they let me out of there, you know, I just tried to take advantage of it. And fortunately, I did. And I was able to provide for my family like I always wanted to. But I, you know, instead of asking God why those things happened to me, I just, you know, believed in him and trust that everything would be all right if I kept fighting and used my talent to the best of my ability.
What was it like, you know, in moving to Georgetown and stuff and, you know, everything's behind you? You're on the court now. What was that feeling like, being on the court, playing, being one of the best players in the country? Can you describe that whole experience at Georgetown?
They really never let me put it behind me, you know, far as the media. But I think Coach Thompson did a great job of keeping those people away from me. Like, for a while, they couldn't even talk to me, you know. And he did a good job making sure that when they did talk to me, it wasn't about those type of things, you know. I thought about it, but I was never, you know, real bitter about it, you know, what happened to me at home. You know, I guess that's why I go back and do the things that I do for the Boys and Girls Club and things like that right now, because, you know, it's done with, you know. I just try to just, you know, forget about it, you know, and I was doing the thing that I love to do the most, and that was just play basketball. And when I'm on a basketball court, I mean, I don't think about anything but basketball. I think that's the only time that I don't think about anything, you know, else. You know, when I'm off the court, you know, so many things going through my mind, so many things that I think about, you know. But basketball is like where I get my peace. And even more than when I'm sleeping, you know, because you still dream. You know, you still dream about negative things, you know, so basketball was like where I could have a peace of mind and just, you know, try to display my God-given talent. And that's what I used it to the fullest. You know, I worked hard as I could when I was at Georgetown. And I think Coach Thompson and my teammates had a lot to do with, you know, helping me, you know, forget about everything. But people always still stereotype me, always felt like I was some type of bad guy because of, you know, what happened to me. And my coach always told me that the most important thing for you to do is get those convictions overturned, because I still had 3 felonies. And, you know, that was like one of the, you know, best times of my life to be in court and then hear that judge overturn what happened to me. You know, because I didn't feel like, you know, I should go, you know, on through the rest of my life with 3 felonies and not be able to vote and, you know, do certain things that I wanted to do.
Did you feel like everything was ahead of you when that moment happened? Did you feel like you'd overcome the worst thing that could happen? What was that feeling in your heart?
I felt like I overcame one of the worst things that ever happened to me. But you don't know what else is gonna happen. You know, I don't know what else is going to happen in my life. You know, I try to be the best husband I can. I try to be the best father. I try to be the best brother, best friend, best cousin. You know, but, you know, things happen in this world that, you know, a lot of times we don't have control over, you know. And this world is not fair, you know. So, I mean, you never know what's going to happen today or tomorrow. It's just about trying to be the best person you can be and looking after the people that need you, you know, and understanding and knowing the people that's out to help you, you know. And that's what I try to recognize, the people that I know that care about me besides Allen Iverson, the basketball player, just Allen Iverson, the person.
Draft day, your number one pick. I mean, just talking about how that was the happiest day of your life. I mean, you're talking about, you're sitting about worrying about taking care of the people who took care of you, and all of a sudden, you hear your name called out, and you know you're going to be able to do that after everything. Describe those emotions.
That was the, you know, best, you know, moment of my career. You know, just being drafted. You know, that was better than MVP, scoring title, making it to the playoffs, making it to the finals. You know, that was my favorite moment, because, you know, I felt like I had did something with my life. And I felt good about my mother, you know, and who she raised and what she went through to raise me. You know, I don't know, I had butterflies so bad. You know, I remember just sitting there. You know, I knew they were gonna call my name, but I didn't know. You know, and once they did, I just felt good. You know, after everything that I've been through, you know, I finally made it to the, you know, the point that I really wanted to get to. And it was like a tribute to my mom and, You know, my dad, Mo, Coach Thompson, and, you know, my sisters, you know, my team, all the teammates that I ever had up to that point. You know, all the people that helped me get there. You know, Miss Lambiat, you know, everybody. You know, and it was just a great feeling. You know, I felt like my life was starting to amount to something.
Talk a little bit about, I mean, it's one thing to get drafted, but you exploded on the league. I mean, even at the end of your rookie year, you know, the flurry of 40-point games. I mean, what was that feeling like to be on the court against guys that, you know, you seen play in the NBA, and you're taking them and schooling them, and, you know, you get more and more confidence as your rookie year is going on. Talk to me, like, how that feeling was to be on the court.
I always just wanted an opportunity to play against those guys. You know, I knew that once I got an opportunity that I was going to showcase my God-given ability, you know, and once I got the opportunity, you know, I just felt like the sky was the limit. And I just played every game like it was my last. And I tried to do everything it took to be a great player in this league. And, you know, a lot of guys, when you see guys that you kind of looked up to, they kind of shy away from the challenge and kind of get scared of the opportunity. And I just took it on. You know, I wanted the opportunity to play against the top guys and to go after them. Instead of being scared, you know, I was confident in what God gave me. And I just played hard as I could. And I was able to have some success. And my rookie year, I had some couple downfalls too. You know, I remember one game I was playing in Phoenix against Kevin Johnson, and he had like 36 points, 9 assists. And I went over to Mo Cheeks and I said, damn, you know, nobody never had a good game like that against me. And he said, don't worry about it, young fella. You know, one of these days, you're gonna get somebody 36 points and 9 assists. You know, and I just looked at it like, you know, a learning experience. And then I had a game where I had, I think, like 4 or 5 points. And it was the lowest I ever had since, I think, rec league when I was a little kid. And I told Harvey Grant, I said, man, that was the worst game I ever played in my life. And he was like, don't worry about that, man. You're going to have a couple more of those games. And I just, you know, that kind of put my career into perspective. You know, all that matters is you go out and play every game like it's your last. And then after the game's over, whether you have a good game, bad game, or mediocre game, you can look in the mirror and look at yourself and say, I did all that I could. And now, you know, that's enough.
You know, it seemed like you guys were progressing each year. You beat Orlando, then you took Indiana to 6 games, and then, you know, last summer, it's amazing that last summer seems like 10 years ago, you know, when I was back looking at some of the tapes and stuff. Well, you know, was that the final hurdle for you? What was that like, going through, you know, the trade rumors and all that?
It was tough, because I know what I've been through as far as being a Sixer. You know, we won 22 games my first season. And then, you know, we got better and better. We went to the playoffs. And I just thought I deserved a little bit more than that as far as me being there and seeing players come and go. Like, you know, I'm the only one on this team from 5 years ago, you know. So I always tease my teammates, say I'm an original Sixer, you know. I'm the only one left, you know. And I've been through hell, and I went through the good times as well, you know. And I played every game like it's my last, and I made some mistakes, you know. And I just felt like I deserved better as far as who they were gonna trade me to, you know, and you know, I felt like, you know, they wouldn't send me to the Clippers of all teams after you know, where I helped bring this team to, you know, at least send me somewhere, you know, to where I could have a chance to win. You know, I don't blame you for sending me to the West Coast so you wouldn't have to deal with me. But, you know, send me to a West Coast team that had a chance to win. I felt bad about that. I felt bad about some of the things fans were saying. And, you know, because, you know, the fans made me sign that contract. You know, they embraced me from day one. And when it was time for me to sign that contract, it was a no-brainer. You know, I always wanted to be a Sixer. My dad was a Sixer fan. And I always wanted to be the first pick. And I never wanted to leave Philadelphia. You know, I wanted to start my career as a Sixer and finish my career as a Sixer. And then for all that stuff to be going on, you know, it felt bad. It was a bad time for me. You know, I could be out in the restaurant and see SportsCenter come on and didn't know if I was being traded to some team. You know, every time I seen a sports show come on, my heart started beating. And I was hearing people in the organization say things about me that I didn't approve of. And it was just rough on me. It was like one of the worst times of my life. But again, I never questioned God why it was happening. You know, and in this situation, I kind of knew why it was happening. And I had a lot to do with it. And I think that was a part of me just growing up, you know. And the things that they told me that I had to take care of to make that thing work, I knew it was things that I could control and I could get a grip on. And I felt like they were little things. So, you know, I just tried to do the things that they always wanted me to do as far as being a leader. And not just leading by my play on the court, you know, off the court as well. And, you know, I just wanted to approach that season like I never approached any other season, you know. I wanted, you know, to where after the season was over, I wanted to be able to look in the mirror and say, you know, you did everything that, you know, everybody wanted you to do as far as being a leader, and you won the championship or you didn't, but you should be proud of yourself. And that's what I did. And after the season was over, I was able to look in the mirror and feel good about everything that I did.
Gary corrected me before. He's like, I said you guys started 9-0. He's like 10-0. Mm-hmm. And I mean, we had tapes here at the media day last year where you were like, wait and see. You know, you were like, just wait and see. I'm the captain of this team. Just wait and see. And it was like you couldn't have written a better script. I mean, like, talk about the All-Star game. I mean, you know, like the up and downs of Coach Brown, and yet, you know, two people you bring out and mention are your mom and Coach Brown.
Yeah, because, you know, my mom, you know, I can't say enough about her. I can't say enough good things about my mom, you know, but Coach Brown helped me so much. Coach Brown helped me to become an MVP basketball player. He helped me to become an All-Star. And it had a lot to do with things that he taught me on the court, you know, mostly. But the things that he helped me with off the court, I think, got me over the hump. You know, he made me a better leader. You know, he made me concentrate on some of the things that I never really paid attention to, you know, become a better leader on and off the court. And, you know, when you have a lot of talent and, you know, and people enable you to not do the things that you know you're supposed to do and they know you're supposed to do to get to that next level, then you won't never get to that level, you know. And he fought with me. And I think that was important for me, you know. And now, then looking back on it, you know, I might have used to look at it like he's just on me and just trying to get in my ass for no reason. But, you know, he was trying to help me all along. You know, I don't see why any coach would want anything negative for you if you're on his team. you know, and he's trying to win. We wanted the same things, you know, out of every season, and that was to win a championship. And all it took with Coach Brown and myself is communication. We never communicated with each other. It was always somebody on the outside saying different things, you know. He would hear something that I said from somebody else and vice versa, you know, instead of us talking to each other. And once we started to communicate with each other, that's when everything got so much better, because I felt like I could talk to him about anything and he could talk to me about anything. And I started to understand, you know, things that he wanted and he needed, and he started to understand the things that I wanted and I needed. And then after a while, you know, we became friends. So now it's like that, you know, between him and I. So now we get into any kind of squabbles or anything, we're friends, and friends gonna get into it. But it's important for friends to talk things out, you know. I always wanted to be his friend instead of just coach and player, you know. And now we're at that point, we're still gonna get, and we're still gonna hit a couple bumps on the way. But hopefully the tire won't flat and we can keep on riding. And that's important, you know. Coach Brown and myself know what it takes to get to the championship, you know. All we have to find out now is what it takes to get there and win it all. And I think if we stick together like we've been doing and trying to do, there won't be any problem.
Great. A couple more, is that okay?
Yeah, it's cool.
Just want to finish this. This is great, by the way. I appreciate it. You know, going into the playoffs, you're playing Indiana. They knocked you guys out previously. You know, coach left there not in great terms. And you lose game one. And all of a sudden, it's all starting again, and the naysayers and stuff like that. Can you talk a little bit about that series and why it was special?
It was bad when we lost that first game. No, because we had them. I think we lost like a 16-18 point lead, something like that. I know it was a big lead. We lost the lead, and they came back and won. And it just felt so bad because that team, we never could get past that team, you know, 2 years. And, you know, everybody was down in the locker room, but we still had to concentrate on the agenda at hand, and that was winning the series. And we knew we had another game to play, and we weren't out of it. And we won the next game, we got our confidence back, winning there, and then we won two more games. But, I mean, I think beating that team helped us get to the finals, because we felt like if we could beat Indiana, you know, that we could get to the finals. We felt like we could beat anybody, you know, because that team had our number for so many years. And, I have a lot of respect for guys on that team because they brought a lot out of myself, and they brought a lot out of my team and my coaching staff, you know. And it was just a great moment for us to get by those guys, and just to get that monkey off our back.
Toronto, you and Vince Carter have some 50-point battles that are unbelievable. And in Game 7, where you have an incredible number of assists. What was it like going up against him in that series in Game 7?
It was fun because, you know, when I'm not playing against him, I like to watch him. You know, because he's an exciting player. You know, you love to see Vince get up and down the court, dunk, and, you know, do all the great moves that he does. It was just fun because I think most of all, I think all the kids enjoyed it. You know, that was a series for the kids. You know, a lot of the fundamentals go out of the door when you talk about Allen Iverson and Vince Carter, because we try to do so many, you know, different things on the court as far as flash. And they got to see, you know, 7 games of excitement. And, you know, he had a chance on that one shot. And, you know, that's what type of battle it was. It came down to one shot, you know, and it was just a fun series, man. I mean, it was tough. a lot of guys on their team bought out things that I didn't know they had. And the guys on my team showed me things that they had been showing me all season. So that was a great series.
I mean, if there's a game that's... one game, ironically, last year that maybe was a game you didn't play against Milwaukee, where your teammates fought so valiantly for you, and I saw you on the sidelines, and like you almost had like tears in your eyes in a loss because of how hard these guys played.
I was in the hotel.
Right.
I was in the hotel on that.
Well, can you talk a little bit about that effort by them, and these were guys they brought in that you've gone through the wars with, and it seemed like the Milwaukee's, where Toronto was single-handedly you, Milwaukee was like, these guys who love you stepped up.
I mean, that game was so fun, you know, to watch. But I mean, I was nervous all the way through the game. But I mean, I really felt that we were gonna win that game. I mean, so many different things happened in that game. So many different people stepped up. And it was just good for me. You know, because I found out a lot about my teammates, more than I even knew. You know, I knew that they were tough. I knew that they played every game like it was their last. I knew they were warriors, but just to see them perform like that, you know, kind of healed me a little bit more, you know. And I just couldn't wait for the opportunity to get on the court with those guys again and just try to take my game to another level. Just try to play just extra hard, you know, because of what they almost pulled out in Milwaukee. And I know that Milwaukee team knew that we were going to be tough to beat once I came back because of how my teammates played without me. And, you know, that was just something else added to that special season. You know, those guys just fought, and they wanted that win. They wanted to come back to the hotel and, you know, see my face and see my reaction. I know they did, but when they got back, I was still right there, you know, and congratulating them on the effort that they gave. And, you know, when I got back to practice, I was just ready. I was just ready, you know, just to get back into it.
Awesome, man. Thank you very much.
All right.
Thanks, Al. Appreciate it. All right.